Can you hear me?
Trying to
okay.
do
yeah.
Okay, good.
Have you gotten used to coming and doing this cycle of with your movies every year?
هنوز بهش عادت نکردم با اینکه چندین باره که این مسیر رو طی میکنم ولی برام مسیر خیلی سختیه.
I'm not used to it yet. Even though I've done this whole trajectory several times now, it's a difficult one for me.
این بخش بعد از فیلم که پروموشن شروع میشه و بعد تعداد زیادی مصاحبه انجام بدی و فیلم رو توضیح بدی خیلی بخش سختیه برای من.
This time after a film where you have to do the promotion and do a number of interviews, it's quite a difficult one for me.
به خاطر اینکه خیلی از سوالا تکراریه و بعد از یه مدت وقتی جوابا رو میدی جوابای تکراری میدی و احساس می‌کنی دیگه خودت نیست و ذهنت نیست که این سوالا رو داره جواب میده، زبونت و به صورت ماشینی و مکانیکی این پاسخ‌ها رو داری میدی.
Because a lot of the questions are repeated and necessarily a lot of the answers become repetitious and then you feel that you're no longer yourself answering, that you're kind of mechanically just answering.
یا اینکه خیلی دوست دارن که چیزهایی رو که توی فیلم وجود داره و خیلی ظریفه و تماشاگر باید کشف کنه و لذت ببره من توضیح بدم. اینم گاهی ناچارم این کارو میکنم ولی خودم احساس خوبی ندارم.
Or there people who address a kind of nuanced, delicate thing that's part of the film that you're hoping the audience will discover and ask me about it and ask me to explain, which isn't something I really want to do, but sometimes I have to.
Well, do you choose to, do you let yourself do it? A lot of filmmakers just say, no, we'll do it.
من الان سعی کردم این رو کم کنم. توی فیلم جدایی خیلی تعدادش زیاد بود مصاحبه ها، الان از شروع با پخش کننده ها قرار گذاشتم که خیلی کمی انجام بدم. امیدوارم در فیلم های بعدی کم و کمتر بشه.
I have now taken to doing fewer and fewer interviews. I've taken to discussing it in advance with the distributors and limiting the number of interviews, and I really hope that in my future films there'll be fewer and fewer interviews.
خوشبختانه برای فیلم فروشنده تونستم در واقع اینو کم کنم و فقط به فرانسه برم برای پروموشن، بلژیک برم و امریکا رو بیام. بقیه کشورها رو نرفتم. خیلی پخش کننده ها ناراحتن بابت این ولی واقعا نمیتونم همش انجام بدم.
Fortunately, I was able to limit the promotional activity for the Salesman to Belgium, France, and coming to the US. I didn't go to any of the other countries, and the distributors weren't pleased, but...
Is it very different in France or Belgium than it is in the US in terms of press?
فرق میکنه. سوالایی که توی امریکا میپرسن با سوالایی که توی فرانسه میپرسن فرق میکنه. تو فرانسه بیشتر سوالای سیاسی میپرسن و گاهی من احساس میکنم که منو به اشتباه با یه سیاستمدار در واقع تصور کردن و انتظار دارن که من راجع به سیاست با دیتیل حرف بزنم که احساس عجیبی دارم چون فکر میکنم که من یه فیلم سازم و نه یه سیاستمدار و خیلی سخته اون بخش پروموشن.
It's quite difficult because I'm going to start over. It's different. In France and in America, the questions are quite different. In France, they frequently ask me political questions, and they focus on politics to such an extent that sometimes I think they've mistaken me for a politician.
ولی چند تا مصاحبه خیلی خوب توی فرانسه داشتم که اونا واقعا و از طریق سینما و فیلم راجع به چیزهای دیگه حرف می‌زدیم. من یه مصاحبه داشتم توی فرانسه که آخرش احساس کردم که اون کسی که با هم داره مصاحبه می‌کنه اصلا فیلم رو ندیده و اومده که من مثل یه موتور گوگل براش یه چیزایی سوالایی که راجع به کشورم داره رو پاسخ بدم.
But there, I had a couple of interviews that were great, that were really complex and where through talking about film we were able to address other things. But I also had an interview with somebody who came and interviewed me, and I felt that they hadn't even seen the film, that maybe through a Google engine they had come up with a few questions and they wanted me to address them.
That's why you don't go to too many interviews. The wider the number of interviews, the more of those questions you get from people.
ولی با شما دوباره قبلا اینترویو داشتم در سالهای گذشته که هر دو تاش خیلی خوب در اومد اتفاقا.
But in past years, you and I have spoken twice, and I remember both of those being great interviews.
Well, you're an interesting figure because you kind of rocketed to the consciousness of the world in a way, even outside of Iran, and have been there since. And now every film is this anticipated event, which must be. And you seem to have reacted somewhat to. You seem to kind of be spreading yourself out across the globe a little bit more and looking more towards other cultures as part of your work, yeah?
Yeah.
یه که شما شخصیت جالبی هستین برای اینکه از ناشناخته بودن با موشک وارد ذهن همه مردم شدین و خودتونم و تو ذهنیت جهانی وارد شدین و حالا همه فیلماتون یه چیزی که همه با انتظار منتظرشونن و خودتونم یه تحولی درتون پیش اومده خودتونو بیشتر توی دنیا پخش دارین میکنین که الان مثل اینکه کارهای بین‌المللی بیشتر انجام
واقعا موقعی که شروع به کار میکنم اینجوری فکر نمیکنم که قراره یه فیلمی بسازم که بین‌المللیه یا تو کشورهای مختلف و دور دیده میشه وقتی که اون کاغذ رو میذارم جلوم و شروع میکنم نوشتن اولین چیزی که به ذهنم میاد اینه که خودم به عنوان تماشاگر این چیزی که دارم می‌نویسم رو باور می‌کنم یا نه در واقع دایره تماشاگران میشن یه نفر و خودم
Honestly when I start working I never think in say international terms or that the people viewing my films will be all over the world when I sit before that piece of paper I really have an audience of one, and that's myself.
Do you think your worldview has changed in the process of spending all this time running around with your movies?
قطعا روی من تأثیر گذاشته سفرهای زیادی که داشتم با فرهنگ‌های مختلف با آدم‌های مختلف روبرو شدم و این تونسته من دنیای من رو دنیای درونی من رو بازتر کنه و گسترده‌تر کنه.
Undoubtedly, this has had an effect on me, having discovered different people, different cultures. There's been an impact on my inner world that's expanded.
ولی تلاش نکردم در این سالها که بین‌المللی تر باشم. اتفاقا برعکس فکر کردم که هر چقدر لوکال تر باشم بهتر میتونم ارتباط برقرار کنم و یکی از دلایلی که برگشتم ایران بعد از فیلم گذشته و فیلم فروشنده رو ساختم شاید این بود
But I don't strive to be more international on the contrary I make more and more local films one of the reasons why I returned to Iran to make The Salesman was precisely this
So did it feel like a homecoming at some level?
احساس برگشتن به منزل بهتون داد.
We were just talking about Verhoeven and you know going back to his roots after yeah. being in Hollywood for a while. You weren't really in Hollywood, but does it feel like you're going back to something a little bit?
قطعا اینجوریه. یعنی با همه مشکلاتی که ممکنه در واقع وجود داشته باشه وقتی که تصمیم میگیرم که توی ایران در واقع فیلم بعدیم رو کار کنم احساس امنیت بیشتری میکنم چون اونجا جاییه که بیشتر میشناسمش.
It's definitely the case, notwithstanding any problems that may exist there. When I decide to go back and make a film there, what I feel is such a greater sense of security because it's what I know best.
That's interesting. Has it changed from the days of a separation and before for you or is it just the familiarity I mean because your films are very intimate it's not as you say it's not overtly political it's not you know necessarily obviously it's there but so has it changed has that world changed for you in that place
آره تغییرات زیادی ایجاد شده هم در خود من هم در ارتباط تماشاگر با فیلم هام توی کشورم که بخشی از این تغییرات که ایجاد شده ممکنه که خطرناک باشه برای من به عنوان یه فیلم ساز، و بخش زیادش هم خیلی در واقع مثل یه ثروت بزرگه.
There have come to be a great deal of changes both in myself and in my relationship to my audiences. There's a risk in one aspect of these changes, and on the other hand, it's also a great wealth.
I guess what has Iran changed in this over this period of time? Is there a distinct change to you, or is it still the same place that you came up in?
منظورم اینه که آیا خود ایران در این مدت از اول که منظورش فیلم جدایی از اون موقع تا به حال خود ایران تحولی درش پیش آمده یا همون جایی که قبلا بود که شما توش کار میکردین؟
با قطعیت میتونم بگم که تغییر در واقع هر روز احساس میشه در واقع رو به جلوه. ممکنه در ظاهر متوجه نشیم، ولی به دلیل اینکه نسل‌های جوونی دارن در واقع حضور اجتماعی پیدا میکنن و ذهن‌های فعال‌تریه، کاملا میشه احساس کرد که فرق کرده وضعیت و رو به جلوه، حرکت عمومی اجتماع رو به جلوه.
I can say with conviction that there's been changes and that there's a forward motion. The generation of young people and mentality of young people makes for a society whose motion is going forward.
One of the most striking things in the movie for me, even though it's not the meat of the movie, is that the opening sequence in which the building is falling apart, we find out at the end of the opening sequence that it's a man-made creation, this destruction. Is falling apart. To me, it's one of the more fascinating it's an aspect of the film that doesn't repeat as such, but it's a profound statement in and of itself. What is that about?
منو باز مجبور میکنی که یه چیزایی رو که نباید توضیح بدم باز کنم، ولی سعی میکنم که یه جوری خیلی غیر مستقیم باز کنم.
You're again forcing me to open up topics that are ones that I don't want to get into, but I'll try to indirectly get in them.
این بخش اول داستان و اون ساختمانی که در آستانه فرو ریختنه، به هر حال در نگاه اول بخشی از قصه است. شما نیاز داریم که اتفاق بیفته که این زن و شوهر از این خونه برن بیرون.
The first segment of the film and that building that's on the point of collapsing is an integral part of moving the story forward, because for whatever it's worth, we need this couple to have to leave that building.
من به عنوان یه تماشاگر، نه به عنوان کسی که این فیلم رو ساختم، اگر این صحنه رو ببینم در ابتدای فیلم، بیش از اینکه دنبال یه معنی خیلی مشخص برای این صحنه تو ذهنم بگردم، فکر کنم که یه حس ناامنی و بی‌ثباتی در من ایجاد میکنه که در طول فیلم این حس با من میمونه. این بیشتر در واقع برام اهمیت داره.
As a viewer, not as the filmmaker, more than anything, what I will be left with from that scene is not a deep meaning. Instead, it's a sense of instability that is going to instability and chaos and upheaval instability and upheaval that is going to stay with me throughout the film. This is the significant aspect of that opening.
معنیش این نیست که من مانع تماشاگر بشم که پشت این صحنه ترجمه ای پیدا نکنه یا در واقع این رو نشانه چیزی نبینه. اون میتونه هر جوری دوست داره فکر کنه، ولی اگه من تماشاگر باشم ترجیح میدم که حس این صحنه رو بگیرم تا معناشو.
This does not mean that that I would prevent. Okay. This does not mean that an audience member could not find a different translation or see this as a sign of something else. But if I were watching the film, I would really want to receive the feeling of this.
Not meaning.
not the meaning.
It reminded me of a moment, of a general, actually, a Russian movie called Nine, where there was this upheaval, physical upheaval of the city going on, and there were dogs wild in the street. One of the things that's striking about this movie, more so differently than the other your other films for me, was this was the incursion of other of ideas from other movies and cultures. Obviously, Death of a Salesman at the center, but there was also, you know, hints, though you probably were writing this before you even saw it or had a chance to see it, of the Denis Villeneuve movie Prisoners, though a very different take on a similar kind of issue. But it was this felt like you know, like you more consciously aware of the rest of the world's cultural elements and kind of bring it all together in your own voice in a clearer way.
برای خود من چیزی که توی این فیلم تجربه تازه‌ای بود و با فیلم‌های دیگه هم فاصله مینداخت این فیلم رو استفاده از یه نمایشنامه توی دل خود این فیلمه و در واقع این تجربه که مرز بین تئاتر و زندگی رو تو مسیر فیلم کم کم بتونم از بین ببرم و این دوتا توی هم حل بشن.
The thing that was a new experience for me in this film, as opposed to my other works, was the use of a work of theater inside of the film, and to attempt in the course of the film to erase the boundary between theater and film.
Mm. What's interesting, because it's a very specific use of the play. It's not... I think that the take on the play is not the take that a lot of people take away from that play as its own entity. You kind of pick the parts that fit your narrative and really left the rest, you know, the biff of it all beside in many ways.
میگه استفاده خیلی مشخصی از نمایش کردین. یعنی اون قسمتایی که به داستانتون می‌خورده وارد این قسمتای دیگه ایشو کنار
گذاشت. I love you have a 40-year-old punk biff, I think that's.
من این نمایشنامه برام مثل یه آینه ای بود جلوی داستان این داستان واقعی که توی قصه وجود داره، داستان اون زوج و دوستانش و اون اتفاقی براشون میفته.
This play to me was like a mirror in front of the story of the couple, their friends in my film.
و با خودم میگفتم که خب یه عده ممکن این نمایشنامه رو نخونده باشن یا تمایلی نداشته باشن که بعد از فیلم هم برن بخونن، اونها نباید قصه رو از دست بدن. اگر کسی علاقه من بود که بیشتر راجع به قصه بدونه، خب میتونه نمایشنامه رو بخونه یا دوباره بخونه و این لینک های بین نمایشنامه و داستان رو پیدا کنه.
I'm sorry, I completely lost that.
من در واقع نمایشنامه مثل یه آینه بود جلوی قصه من و من از بخش های استفاده کردم که این خصوصیت رو درش در واقع تقویت کنه.
The play was like a mirror before my film, and I used the aspects of it that served that purpose. I didn't want somebody who was not familiar with the play not to be able to follow the story of my film. Rather, that if they wanted to, they could go and read the play later or reread it, but still be able to enter my film without knowledge of the play.
صحنه ای که من از نمایشنامه انتخاب کردم صحنه ایه که ویلی رومان میره بوستون و با یه زنی توی هتل هست و پسرش در واقع انتظارش رو نداره سر میرسه و اون صحنه رو میبینه.
The scene I selected out of the play was a scene where Willie Loman goes to Boston to see a woman in a hotel, and unexpectedly his son arrives and sees this.
این صحنه توی نمایشنامه از اون صحنه مهمی نمیاد، ولی شروع بحران توی خانواده ویلی لومان از این صحنه است.
In the play, this does not appear to be a very significant moment, but it's the start of the crisis in Willie Loman's family.
همش احساس می‌کنم که بیف وقتی پدرش رو با اون زن می‌بینه، چیزی که خیلی آزارش میده و برای همیشه از پدرش متنفر میشه، کاریه که ویلی لومان برای رد کردن اون زن انجام میده، یک جفت جوراب به اون زن هدیه میده.
I always feel that what marks Biff and makes him hate his father thereafter is witnessing what Willy Loman does in order to kind of get rid of this woman, which is to give her a pair of stockings.
و اون پسریه که همیشه تو خونه دیده که مادرش جوراب‌های پاره رو و سوراخ رو بخیه میزنه و دوباره ترمیم میکنه که باز استفاده بشه.
This is the son who's always witnessed his mother mending her stockings.
بیف به این دلیل از پدرش متنفر نیست که اون با یه زن غریبه در ارتباطه. از تحقیری که مادرش شده ناراحته.
The reason why Biff hates his father is not that he's with another woman. It's the humiliation that he's imposed on his mother.
و چیزی که آزارش میده اینه که مادرش نمیخواد در واقع متوجه بشه که چه خبره، دنیا چه خبره و میخواد همچنان ویلی رومان رو ساپورت کنه.
And the thing that also bothers him is his mother's denial, her not wanting to see what is going on and her desire to continue to support Willy Loman.
یکی از مهمترین تم‌هایی که توی نامه‌نامه مرگ یک فروشنده آرتور میلر وجود داره همین تم تحقیره.
One of the most significant themes in Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman is this theme of humiliation.
آدم‌ها توی اون فیلم همه احساس می‌کنن تحقیر شدن و همزمان دارن دیگران رو تحقیر می‌کنن.
People in that film all feel that they have been humiliated and are concurrently humiliating other people.
بیف احساس می‌کنه که ویلی لومان لیندا رو تحقیر کرده، مادرش رو.
Biff feels that Willy Loman has humiliated Linda, his mother.
ویلی لومان احساس می‌کنه که پسرش داره اون رو تحقیر می‌کنه، همسایه‌ها و همکاراش دارن تحقیرش می‌کنن و اجتماع رو داره تحقیر می‌کنه.
Willy Loman feels that his son, his neighbors, his co-workers, the whole of society is humiliating him.
تنها کسی که توی اون شخصیت‌های اصلی احساس نمی‌کنه که داره تحقیر میشه، اگرچه تحقیر شده، لینداست.
The only individual, the only character who does not feel that they've been humiliated, although they have been, is Linda.
توی نامه‌نامه مرگ فروشنده اون صحنه هتل و حمام قرینه صحنه‌ای که توی در واقع فیلم فروشنده وجود داره، اون صحنه حمام که ما اون رو نمی‌بینیم.
In Death of a Salesman, the scene of the hotel and the bathroom is the equivalent of the bathroom scene that we don't see.
ما یه چیزهایی رو از داستان واقعی که توی فیلم هست، داستان این زوج، حذف کردیم و به جاش یه چیزهایی رو از نمایشنامه گذاشتیم. این دوتا همدیگه رو تکمیل کردن.
We've eliminated some things out of the real life story of our couple and replaced it with parts of the play so that these two complement and complete each other.
اون زن مستأجر قبلی خونه که زن و شوهر بهش میرن، همون زن فاحشه، توی ما هیچ موقع نمیبینیمش توی فیلم، ولی توی نمایشنامه و کسی که داره اون نقش رو بازی میکنه، نقش زنی که توی هتل هست رو میبینیم.
The previous tenant, the woman who's the prostitute, is someone that we never see, but in the play we see the person playing that role from the play.
به همین دلیل گفتم که این برام تجربه تازه‌ای بود که بتونم مرز زندگی و تئاتر رو از بین ببرم و این دوتا برن توی هم حل بشن.
This is what I meant when I said that I tried to erase the boundary between these two so that they could enter each other and dissolve inside each other.
So when you sat down to write, was there a movie that didn't have anything to do with Death of a Salesman that eventually evolved? I mean, which I guess I'm asking chicken or egg on this. Was this idea conceived as a merger of this way of telling a story, or was it an idea that then you realized connected to something you felt about Death of a Salesman? Or?
من اول با داستان خودم شروع کردم، یعنی داستان این زوج رو نوشتم، خلاصش رو نوشتم و بعد دنبال یه نمایشنامه گشتم که اونا در حال اجرا باشن.
I began with my story, that is to say the story of a couple, and then I was looking for a play that they would be in the process of producing.
حتی قبل از اینکه دنبال این نمایشنامه بگردم نمیدونستم شغل این زن و شوهر چی هست و خیلی به این فکر کردم و بعد متوجه شدم که نمیتونن هنرپیشه باشن.
Before even getting there, I had had some, I had for some time wondered what is the job of this couple. And it was later that I came to the conclusion that they could be actors.
خیلی از این که تصمیم گرفتم اینا هنرمند بشن در واقع احساس کردم یه در مهمی باز شد برام و قصه رو یه لایه جدید بهش داد.
This coming to decide that they were going to be actors, I felt opened a new door for me and added a whole new layer to the story.
هنرپیشه‌ها یه ویژگی دارن، میتونن به خاطر کار هنرپیشگی و شغلشون خودشون رو جای دیگران بذارن.
A quality that actors have because of their job, which is unique to them, is that they can put themselves in another's place.
شخصیت اصلی ما میتونه هر شب بره رو صحنه و خودش رو جای ویلومان بذاره و تلاش کنه که جوری بازی کنه که تماشاگر با شخصیت ویلومان هم دردی کنن.
Our main character can go on stage every night and play Willy Loman and put all his effort into gaining the empathy of the audience for Willy Loman.
حالا همین شخصیت با این توانایی که میتونه خودش رو جای دیگران بذاره در زندگی واقعی با یه فروشنده‌ای روبرو میشه که یه ورژن ایرانی از ویلی لومان و احساس میکنه که نمیتونه خودش رو جای اون بذاره، نمیتونه اون آدم رو درک کنه.
Now the same character who has this ability to empathize encounters an Iranian version of Willy Loman but comes to realize that he's not able to empathize with him.
این یه پارادوکسیه که توی این شخصیت اصلی به وجود میاد.
This is the paradox that comes to exist in our protagonist.
و این در واقع ویژگی شغل اونها بود، یعنی اون هرچی که برام جذاب بود و منو برد به سمت اینکه یه نمایشنامه پیدا کنم.
And this was the main feature of their job as actors that then led me to look for a play.
و وقتی نمایشنامه مرگ فروشنده رو دوباره بعد از 20 سال خوندم خیلی عجیب بود برام. احساس می‌کردم که انگار آرتور میلر میدونسته یه روزی یه کسی یه فیلم به نام فروشنده می‌سازه که برای من یه چیزایی رو آماده گذاشته بود تو نمایشنامه‌اش. اینقدر لینک‌هایی که وجود داشت زیاد بود.
And then when I came to read Death of a Salesman after 20 years, I was struck by the parallels that existed. It was as though Arthur Miller knew that somebody was going to come to this play and make a film called The Salesman.
The funny thing for me, the structure of the play is almost more important for her in that it keeps her open as a character, because the tendency to want to shut down, which she has after being attacked, she doesn't have the option, because the show must go on. She wants to go and perform.
Yeah.
So it actually keeps her alive and open to the world, which is a critical, I think, in terms of storytelling.
به نظرم هر دوی اونها و مخصوصا اون زن میخواد که در واقع زندگی رو ادامه بدن، ولی و تلاششون هم میکنن، میخوان حتی به قانون مراجعه کنن، ولی موانعی به وجود میاد که اونا رو و مخصوصا اون مرد رو به یه سمت دیگه میبره.
I think both of them wish to carry on living, go on with their lives, even go to the police, but obstacles arise that force them in a different direction.
So I wonder whether if she didn't have the play to go to, whether she would be in the same place as him or more the same place as him emotionally when the ultimate confrontation takes place.
میگه برام این سوال پیش میاد که اگر زنه این نمایشنامه رو مجبور نبود توش بازی کنه، اینو نداشت که رو بهش برگرده، آیا از لحاظ احساسی بیشتر تو همون فضا و جوی وارد میشد که شوهرش وارد شده؟
نه، به نظرم بیشتر اذیت میشد. اتفاقا اگر اون بخش حضورش توی اجتماع از طریق تئاتر نبود، اون در واقع منزوی تر میشد.
No, I think that she would suffer much more. I think if that aspect of her participation in the theater didn't exist, she would be more isolated.
من وقتی که می نوشتم این داستان رو یه تحقیق کردم راجع به آدمایی که این اتفاق براشون میفته.
I was writing this story, I did some research about people who have this kind of experience?
اونها در واقع به لحاظ روحی روانی چند تا مرحله رو بعد از این اتفاق میگذرونن.
After such an incident, they undergo several stages in terms of their feelings and their psychological state.
مرحله اول اینه که اینا شوک میشن تا چند روز توی شوک هستن. مرحله دوم اینه که اونا اصلا انکار میکنن که این اتفاق افتاده و مرحله سوم اینه که منزوی میشن. همینجور که این زن دیگه توی تئاتر کار نمیکنه و از طرف بقیه یه جوری منزوی میشه.
The first stage is shock. In the second instant, there's a stage of denial. And then there's a stage of isolation. The same way that in the theater, she's not really working in the same way and she feels set aside from the rest of the team.
I was speaking more to the idea that she would be, she would probably be perhaps more vengeful had she not had an outlet to go through those stages, which I think the theater allows her.
این سوالش یعنی در واقع میگه که اگر این موقعیت رو نداشت که برگرده به تئاتر، از لحاظ داستانی ممکنه که این زن به جای اینکه این حالت عفو و دل باز رو داشته باشه بیشتر میرفت به اون سوی که شوهرش رفته که به سوی انتقامه.
من چنین احساسی ندارم، یعنی این شخصیتی رو که توی فیلم وجود داره، این شخصیت زن رو احساس نمی‌کنم که بتونه مسیری رو که شوهرش رفت طی کنه.
That's not my feeling. In terms of this female character, I don't feel that she's capable of following the path that her husband chose to follow.
ولی این کاملا چیز شخصیه. این بستگی داره به تماشاگر. من به لحاظ شخصی همیشه زنها رو کسایی می‌بینم که به سمت جلو حرکت میکنن، متوقف نمیشن روی چیزی که در آب بمونن، و مردها بیشتر کسایی هستن که به پشت سرشون نگاه میکنن و به گذشته و اون رو میخوان کند و کاف کنن.
I mean this is something personal. It depends on the person seeing the film, but for my own part I always feel that women tend to want to move forward and to be moving ahead, and men are more stuck in a place and looking behind them.
So speaking of moving forward, we have to leave, but I just wanted to ask before we went, you've now been selling this movie for a year, you've been started with Cannes almost a year now, on this process. Have you moved on? Are you on to the next project and thinking about other things? And does the movie kind of subside in your thoughts as you get to the end of this process?
من دارم روی فیلمنامه کار میکنم که قرار بود قبل از فیلم فروشنده اون رو کار کنم.
I'm working on a screenplay and it's a project that I was supposed to work on before The Salesman.
که بعد یه تصمیم گرفتم و همه قرارمدارا رو در واقع عوض کردم و اومدم فروشنده رو ساختم. الان همچنان رو اون فیلمنامه دارم کار میکنم.
But then I made a decision, changed all the plans. And now I've come back. I made The Salesman, and now I've gone back, and I'm working on that project.
فکر میکنم اگر فیلمنامه تموم بشه به موقع و خودم راضی باشم ازش، تابستون بتونم اون رو شروع کنم امسال.
I think if the screenplay is finished and if I'm pleased with it, I should be able to start working this summer on that project.
برای من تجربه تازه ایه که چون که باز توی فرهنگ دیگه است و به زبان اسپانیاییه و یه پروداکشن کاملا در واقع غیر ایرانی خواهد بود.
It'll again be a novel experience for me because it'll be in a different culture. It's in Spanish with a totally non-Iranian production.
And when you're done with The Salesman, are you done emotionally, or do you move? Does it become a memory, or does it linger with you?
نه هنوز تموم نشده. تلاش دارم میکنم که جدا بشم از اون فیلم، ولی پروسه پروموشن و مصاحبه کردن ها نمیذاره که من دور بشم از اون فیلم. امیدوارم به زودی این مرحله در واقع به انتها برسه.
No, that hasn't happened yet. I'm trying, but this process of promoting and doing interviews doesn't really allow me to move away from that film, though I hope to soon.
Thank you so much for your time.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.